Hi everyone. Depression is a complex mental health condition that affects millions of people worldwide every year. Now, while there's no one definitive cause of depression, we do know that it involves various changes in the brain structures and function. In today's video, we're going to be discussing some of the parts of the brain that are involved in depression and how each of these brain regions plays a unique role in the development and expression of depression symptoms. By understanding the neurobiology of depression, we can gain some insight into how psychological treatments like cognitive behavioral therapy actually causes changes in these brain structures to help manage depression symptoms through a process called neuroplasticity. But before I get into that, just a couple of disclaimers to go over. I'm a registered psychologist in the province of British Columbia, Canada. And this video is for informational purposes only. It is not intended as a substitute or replacement for advice from your doctor or mental health professional. Now, with those things out of the way, let's start talking about the neurobiology of depression. And as I mentioned before, depression is a common mental health disorder that affects people of all ages and backgrounds. And it's more than just feeling sad or down. Depression is a persistent and pervasive feeling of hopelessness, sadness, and lack of interest in activities that a person used to enjoy doing. It can cause physical symptoms like changes in sleep and appetite, and difficulties with concentration and making decisions. And while depression can have many causes, including genetic, environmental, and psychological factors, it's important to understand that it's not just a mood disorder. Depression affects many different systems in the body, including the brain. And the brain, it's a complex organ that's responsible for many different functions, including regulating emotions, thoughts, and behaviors. And there are several key brain structures that have been linked to depression. And the ones that we're going to be talking about are the prefrontal cortex, the amygdala, the hippocampus, and the striatum. So, let's start with the prefrontal cortex. You can think of the prefrontal cortex kind of like the CEO of your brain, responsible for making important decisions, planning, organizing, paying attention to things that matter. It helps us to think about the future, set goals, and make choices that align with our values and priorities. Now imagine that the CEO of a company suddenly loses interest in their job. They struggle to make decisions, they can't seem to focus on tasks that need to be done, and they lack motivation to do anything. This is a little bit like what happens in the brains of people with depression. The prefrontal cortex isn't functioning as well as it should. And studies have shown that the prefrontal cortex is often underactive in people with depression. And what this means is that it's not working as hard as it should be, which can result in difficulties with decision-making and planning. And when the prefrontal cortex isn't functioning properly, it can be hard to set goals and follow through on them. It can also make it difficult to focus on tasks, which can lead to procrastination and avoidance. All of these things are common in depression. Additionally, this underactivity in the prefrontal cortex can cause people with depression to lose interest in activities that they used to enjoy. And this can result in a lack of motivation and engagement with the world around them. For example, someone who used to love hiking may now find it difficult to even just get off the couch and go for a walk. The next part of the brain that I want to talk about is the amygdala, which is this small almond-shaped structure located deep in your brain. The amygdala is responsible for processing emotions like fear and anxiety. It's essentially the brain's alarm system, detecting potential threats in the environment and triggering a response in order to keep us safe. In people with depression, the amygdala is often overactive. And what that means is that the amygdala is working too hard, which can lead to an exaggerated response to negative events. So, for example, imagine that I'm walking down the street and someone bumps into me. If my amygdala is overactive, I might interpret this as a deliberate act of aggression, even if it was just an accident. And this can lead to a heightened sense of fear and anxiety and an exaggerated response to negative emotional events in general. And research has found that people with depression have increased activity in the amygdala when they're exposed to negative emotional stimuli, like sad or angry faces. And this heightened activity can contribute to the negative emotional biases that we commonly see in depression. And these biases can make it difficult for us to see positive aspects of a situation and can lead to that pervasive sense of hopelessness and despair that's common in depression. Additionally, overactivity in the amygdala can lead to changes in other areas of the brain. For example, increased activity in the amygdala has been linked to reduced activity in the prefrontal cortex, which we talked about earlier. And so what this can do is it can make it even harder to regulate emotions, make decisions, and plan for the future. The next part of the brain I want to talk about is the hippocampus. And the hippocampus is a small structure in the brain that plays a crucial role in memory formation and recall. It helps us to remember the events in our lives, helps us to learn new things, and to navigate our surroundings. In people with depression, the hippocampus is often smaller in size than in healthy individuals. And this reduced size of the hippocampus can lead to difficulties with memory and recall, as well as decreased ability to form new memories. And when the hippocampus is smaller, we have a harder time creating and retrieving memories, which can lead to forgetfulness and difficulty learning new information. Again, this is pretty commonly seen in depression. It also makes it more difficult for us to recall information from our past. Now, it's important to note that the relationship between depression and the hippocampus, it's complex and not fully understood. So although the hippocampus is often smaller in people with depression, it's not clear whether this is a cause or a consequence of depression. Now, some researchers believe that chronic stress, which is often associated with depression, can lead to shrinkage in the hippocampus. And whereas other researchers believe that having a smaller hippocampus may predispose someone to developing depression. But regardless of the exact relationship between depression and the hippocampus, it's clear that this brain structure plays an important role in your ability to form and retrieve memories. And when it's not properly functioning, as is often the case with people with depression, this can lead to difficulties with memory and recall, which are some critical symptoms that people experience with depression. And finally, the striatum is an area of the brain just above the brainstem and below the cortex that's made up of several subregions. And the striatum is the part of the brain that's involved in reward processing and motivation. It's responsible for helping us to feel pleasure and motivation when we engage in activities that are important for our survival, things like eating or having sex. In people with depression, the striatum can become underactive. And this means that it's not working as well as it should be, and this underactivity can contribute to symptoms of depression. When the striatum is underactive, it can lead to a decrease in the ability to feel pleasure and motivation. And this can cause people with depression to lose interest in activities that used to be enjoyable, and can lead to a person struggling with basic tasks like just getting out of bed in the morning. And this reduced activity in the striatum may be one of the reasons why people with depression have a harder time feeling pleasure and motivation. It's like their brain's reward center isn't online, it's not functioning properly, which can lead to a lack of interest in activities that they used to find enjoyable. We call this anhedonia. Now, just like I mentioned with the hippocampus, the relationship between the striatum and depression is complex. While it's clear that the striatum plays an important role in reward processing and motivation, and that the striatum can be underactive in depression, it's not clear whether this is a cause or a consequence of depression. So, Now that we understand these various areas of the brain that are involved or influenced by depression, the question is, what can we do about this? Is there any way we can change our brain? And the surprising answer is yes. Forms of psychotherapy, like cognitive behavioral therapy, which is the type of therapy that I do, can change and alter some of these brain structures through a process called neuroplasticity. In other words, we can literally rewire our brain by changing our thinking patterns and changing our behavior. And cognitive behavioral therapy focuses on changing negative thought patterns and behavior patterns that contribute to depression. And in doing so, they can influence the prefrontal cortex, the amygdala, the hippocampus, and the striatum in order to help overcome depression. Cognitive behavioral therapy aims to help people with depression reframe negative thoughts and behaviors, which can alter and increase activity in the prefrontal cortex. By changing negative thought patterns and behaviors, people can improve their ability to make decisions and plan, as well as increase their motivation to engage in activities that they used to enjoy doing. This is referred to top-down cognitive control of emotions, which involves using higher-order areas of the brain, like the prefrontal cortex, to regulate emotional processes in lower-order areas of the brain, like the striatum and the amygdala. And cognitive behavioral therapy has been shown to reduce activity in the amygdala by teaching people how to reframe negative thoughts and regulate their emotions. By learning how to better manage and regulate emotions, people can reduce feelings of fear and anxiety, which often contribute to symptoms of depression. Cognitive behavioral therapy has also been shown to actually increase the size of the hippocampus, potentially by reducing stress and promoting increased relaxation. And by reducing stress, this can promote neurogenesis, which is the growth of new brain cells, which can help increase the size of the hippocampus. And finally, cognitive behavioral therapy may help to increase activity in the striatum by encouraging people to engage in activities that they find rewarding and enjoyable. By engaging in these pleasurable activities, people may be able to activate their brain's reward center and increase their motivation to engage in more pleasurable and rewarding behaviors. So it's possible that through psychological treatments like cognitive behavioral therapy, we can actually change the activity and structures in our brain through this process of neuroplasticity. But it's also important to note that the exact mechanism by which cognitive behavioral therapy works to treat depression isn't fully understood. We just know that there is a relationship between cognitive behavioral therapy and these changes in brain processes and structures. But I think it's pretty cool to think that we actually do have the ability to change our brains. And if you're interested in learning more about cognitive behavioral therapy and how it works, I'd encourage you to check out this video. So that's all for today's video. As always, thank you for making it all the way to the end of this video, and I'll see you in the next one.